Om Namah Shivaya. I'm Sanchita Roy. Welcome to class 11's biology class. Today I'm going to discuss the chapter number 20, locomotion and movements, part 2. In my previous video, I have already discussed about the comparison between locomotion and movements. We have seen locomotion is what when an organism changes its position from one place to another, we call it as locomotion. Whereas movements is what when any part of the body is changing its position. You don't need to change from one place to another. Substances are continuously moving inside the body of an organism. All locomotion is movement, but all movements does not mean locomotion. Plants do not locomote. They do not move from one place to another, but still they show the movements. We can see the leaves are moving. We can see the movement is taking place from the roots. The water is being transported to the leaves where the photosynthesis is taking place. So that is an invisible movement which is taking place. Over here in this chapter, we are discussing about the locomotion and movements in human beings. So we have discussed the what are the different types of movements can be exhibited in the human body. They are the amoeboid movement, ciliary movement and muscular movement. We have seen amoeboid movements are where do we see the amoeboid movement? The leukocytes or the macrophages, that is the part of the WBCs, they perform the amoeboid movement for killing or destroying the pathogen that enters into our body. Ciliary movement, we have seen that the walls of the nasal tract, the fallopian tubes are having ciliated epithelial tissue, and due to the movement of the cilia, it helps in the movement of the substances around it. So we have seen those. Then today we are going to discuss about the muscular movement. How the muscles are helping in bringing about the movement in the human body. So if we see the muscles are made up of highly specialized thin and elongated cells called the muscle fibers. The muscles are made up of long elongated structures. They are the muscle fibers. Muscle arises from the embryonic mesoderm. We know that we are triploblastic. That is, we have developed from three germinal layers, ectoderm, mesoderm and endoderm. So the muscles are mesodermal in origin. It makes about 40-50% of the human body weight. What are the special properties of the muscles? If we see the muscles, we see that they are showing two special type of characteristics. What is that? The contractibility and excitability. Contractibility means what? The cells of the muscles can be shortened considerably and return to the original relaxed state. Over here you can see the muscles are getting shortened, the biceps muscles are getting shortened, due to which we are able to move the arm upwards. At the same time, this muscle, the triceps, is getting what? It is getting relaxed. On the other hand, over here you can see the biceps are coming down, getting relaxed, and the triceps are getting contracted. So we will see that all the movement, the skeletal movement, are brought about by a antagonistic. The muscles functions in an antagonistic manner. That means there will be two pair of muscles which are responsible for bringing about the movement. Now one muscle will contract, the other will relax. It will always go simultaneously. You can see over here the biceps are getting contracted and the triceps are getting relaxed. On the opposite diagram, we can see that the biceps are relaxing and the triceps are getting contracted. Because of these two muscles working simultaneously at the same time, one will get relaxed, the other will contract. This type of movement is called antagonistic movement. Okay, so the muscles contract and relax. Due to this contraction and relaxation, the movement is brought about by the muscles. The another property of the muscles is excitability. It is due to the energy stored in the electrical potential differences across the plasma membrane. Across the plasma membrane, there is an electrical potential differences, that is due to the positive negative charges, we will see in the later part when this positive negative charge will get changed, during which what is going, the muscles are getting excited and which are responsible for bringing about the movement. Other distinguishing properties are what? Extensibility and elasticity. The muscles can extend, the muscles are able to extend to a certain limit. At the same time, they are showing elasticity. Because of this elasticity nature, they do not tear up easily. Some of the important features of the muscles. The muscle tissue is the most abundant tissue in the most animals. In most of the animals, muscle tissues are the maximum amount of tissues which are present in the body of an individual. Human body has some 639 separate muscles that bring about movement in majority of the animals. The study of muscle is called myology. Muscle of Irish and ciliary body are ectodermal in origin. At the beginning of this video, I said that muscles are mesodermal in origin. There is an exception. What is there? Where the exceptions are there? Iris, which is present in the eye, and the ciliary body. These are the muscles which are present in the eye. They are ectodermal in origin. The largest and the biggest muscle in the human body is the gluteus maximus, that is the hip muscle. You can see the gluteus maximus. This is the largest or the biggest muscle in the human body. The longest muscle is sartorius or the back muscle. The sartorius, it is the over here, you can see. This is the longest muscle. The shortest muscle is the masseter, that is the jaw muscles, over here the jaw muscles, which is helping in the movement of the lower jaw. So this muscle is the shortest muscle. The longest smooth muscle is rectus abdominis. The rectus abdominis, over here you can see, the rectus abdominis is the longest smooth muscles. The muscles we will read little later, what are they? The muscles can be differentiated into voluntary, involuntary and cardiac muscles. So over here, this is what, the skeletal muscles or the voluntary muscles, whereas the smooth muscles, that is the involuntary muscles, the longest, the toughest, longest smooth muscle is the abdominis. It is present in the abdomen region, and the shortest muscle, the shortest smooth muscle is the stapedial muscle, which is present in the internal ear. Okay, as the smallest bones are present in the ear, they are the stapes, malleus and insipidus. So what is there? The smallest muscle, the stapedius, is present in the internal ear of the human body. What are the types of muscles? Muscles have been classified using different criteria. They can be categorized into different types on the basis of their location. On the basis of the location, we have categorized the muscles into different categories. What are they? This is the skeletal muscles or the striated muscles, or they are also known as the voluntary muscles. On the other hand, cardiac muscles. Cardiac muscles which are present in the heart, whereas skeletal muscles which are present to be found attached to the skeletal system of the body. The cardiac muscles are present in the walls of the heart, whereas the smooth muscles are present in the soft organs of the body, like in the stomach, in the small intestine or in the walls of the large intestine. Now let us see what are the characteristic features of these muscles. In skeletal or the striated muscles, its function is association with the skeleton of the organism. You can see they are associated with the skeleton, with the bones. They are associated with the bones of the body. Under the microscope, they have a stripped appearance and hence are called striated muscles. You can see there are striations. Light and dark bands are present in these muscle tissues. Because of this light and dark band present in them, we call them as the striated muscle tissue. They are also known as voluntary muscles, as their activities are under the voluntary control of the nervous system. They are referred as the voluntary muscles. Why? Because we can control their movement. You want to move your hand, you want to move your leg, it is under our control. So they are known as voluntary muscles. The major component of the muscles is the water, and potassium is the most abundant mineral element. The most abundant mineral element is the potassium. They are similarly involved in the locomotory actions and changes of the body posture, as because they are under the control of our body, so they are responsible for bringing about the movement. Visceral of the smooth muscles. They are found in the inner walls of the hollow visceral organs of the body, like the alimentary canal, reproductive tract, etc. Those soft organs are having the visceral smooth muscles. Over here you can see the whole alimentary canal is made up of smooth muscles. The walls of the alimentary canal is having combinations of longitudinal and circular muscles. These muscles are what they are spindle shaped, and these muscles, what is there, they sometimes get fatigued, whereas the striated muscles which we have just seen, the muscles which are attached to the skeletal system, they become fatigued very quickly, that is they get tired. Suppose when you are doing exercise, when you are walking for a long time or you are standing for a longer time, our leg starts aching. Our hand starts aching when we are doing exercise or when you are carrying heavy load, because our muscles are getting stressed, and due to that the pain sensation can be felt by us. In case of the smooth muscles, they do not exhibit any striations, that is smooth in appearance. In the striated muscles, we have seen what there are dark and light bands, but over here you won't see there is any dark and light bands. They are spindle shaped, they are uninucleated, the nucleus is located centrally, whereas in case of the striated muscles, the nucleus is located towards the periphery. They are also known as involuntary muscles, as they are not under the voluntary or direct control of the nervous system. These muscles, what they are, they work autonomically. They keep functioning of their own. It cannot be controlled by our will and wish. Can we restrict the function of the digestive system? No, you stop digestion now. No, we cannot. Because it is a continuous process, and it is the responsibility of these smooth muscles to keep on functioning continuously. They assist in the transportation of materials, that is movement of food through the digestive tract and the gametes through the genital tract. So this is the work of the smooth muscles. Clear? Where are they found? Found in the walls of many internal organs like stomach, intestine, bladder, urinary bladder is also having the smooth muscles, respiratory pathways. So all these are having the smooth muscles. Peristalsis, wave-like contraction that move food through the digestive tract. We don't have to push the food through the digestive tract. The food continuously passes of its own by the peristaltic movement of the alimentary canal, that is by the continuous contraction and relaxation of the walls of the alimentary canal helps the movement of the food through the alimentary canal. Cardiac muscles. Cardiac muscles are what? It occurs in the walls of the heart and in the walls of the large veins. Example, pulmonary veins and the superior vena cava, where these veins enter the heart. These are striated and involuntary in nature. The cardiac muscles are having striations. You can see they are having light and dark bands like the striated muscles. But what is there? They are involuntary in nature. We cannot control the movement of the cardiac muscles. The way we could have controlled the movement of the voluntary muscles, the cardiac muscles movement or functioning cannot be controlled by our will and wish. It is working involuntarily. Oblique bands and intercalated disc are their characteristic features. What is there? You can see there are oblique bands. There are the muscles are obliquely placed over here, and this type of connection between the two cardiac muscles, this is referred as the intercalated disc. That is when two cardiac muscles are connected by an oblique muscle, we call it as intercalated disc. Okay. It assembles in a branching pattern to form a cardiac muscle. They never get fatigued. The cardiac muscles never get fatigued. In case of smooth muscles, sometimes they become fatigued, but the cardiac muscles do not get fatigued, and they are the muscles which keep on functioning continuously. The striated muscles need rest. You cannot keep on functioning or doing exercise continuously, because our muscles get tired, they get exhausted, so we need to take a rest. But the cardiac muscles cannot take rest. If they take a rest, then we will be taking rest for all. Okay. So, two types of muscle fibers are found in the body: slow twitch in muscles that require endurance and fast twitch in muscles that contract quickly. So, these are the two types of fibers. High intensity exercise causes an increase in the muscle mass, and while low intensity exercise, aerobic exercise, build mass but do not burn calories. To burn out calories, high intensity exercises are required. So people, when they need to lose weight, what they have to do? They have to perform high intensity exercise. High intensity exercise will help them to lose their weight, to shed off the muscular mass. Whereas in low intensity exercise or the aerobic exercise, when performed by an individual, they will help in building the body mass, but it will not help in the burning of the calories. So if you want to lose weight, if you want to lose calories, then a person has to do high intensity exercise. So you have to make a comparison chart between the three types of muscle tissues, that is the striated, unstriated, or the smooth muscles and the cardiac muscles. So write in a tabular form the comparisons between the three types of muscles, which often comes in the exam. Whenever you have to write the comparison, please keep it in mind that you have to draw the diagram in support to your answer. In biology, it is very important that the students have to provide diagrams, relevant diagrams, when they are asked in the exam. Whether it is asked to write the diagram, draw the diagram or not, but if the diagram is possible for the given question, it is your duty to provide diagram for the explanation of the question given to you. Thank you. Om Namah Shivaya.